Earth. The four polar conjecture are the particular case of Hilbert's tennis problem.
Here is the statement of the problem. I like to give it in original German because it is much more expressive than official English translation. From the German original, we can judge that Hilbert believes in positive solution of his problem. What about the four-color conjecture? There is a curve on island in the ocean, divided into several countries. There should be connected areas, and we want to assign colors to each country in such a way that two neighboring countries would have different colors. And the conjecture states that for any map, it would be sufficient to use only four colors. This is a very old conjecture from 19th century, but Hilbert did not include this conjecture into his problems explicitly. But you will see that implicitly it is present among his problems. So now we know that the tennis problem is undecidable. There is no algorithm which will give us the answer if the equation has a solution or not. And this was obtained as a corollary of what is called typically DPRM theorem, but was named N-R-B-D theorem somehow in today's talk. So this theorem states that every recursive set of natural numbers has a definite representation. It is the membership to this set can be reduced to solving a particular definite equation. And this theorem has many other interesting corollaries. For example, we can construct particular definite equations related to some other difficult problems. We can construct such an equation which has a solution if and only if Fermat-Schwarz theorem is true. We can construct another equation which has a solution if and only if Weber's conjecture is true. Weber's conjecture states that every even prime greater than 2 is sum of two primes. It's not so evident, but we can construct a particular equation which has no solution if and only if the Riemann hypothesis is true. And we can construct another equation which has no solution if and only if the four-color conjecture is true. I gave a lot of talks about Hilbert's problem, and before experts like you and before more general audience, and usually I listed these reductions and then made an extra explanation. Well, we have a formal proof of instability of Hilbert's problem. We know that there is no Turing machine which would solve it. But here we have, so to say, informal psychological explanation why definite equations are so difficult. It would be unbelievable that so many, so different, and so difficult problems could be solved by a single method which Hilbert asked to devise for in his tenth problem. But the question then arises whether we can use somehow these reductions for proving something. And hardly we can use any of these equations to solve any of these problems, and you want to give another proof of these problems. Because the resulting equation would be very complicated, and we know that there is no universal method. But we can change the order of things, and we know that we cannot have a universal method for all equations. We need to invent more and more specific methods. And now that the four-color conjecture was proved by Ben Hacken, we can treat the proof It's a very specific method for showing that very particular equation has no solutions. And one could try to, so to say, distill this technique and try to apply it to other equations. And so I will speak about this particular equation. And in a sense, this is a triviality now that we have a proof of the Fokker conjecture. We could just take an equation which has no solution and this will be done. And the point, of course, is that we can construct such an equation without the assumption that the Fokker conjecture is true. And that is why I will be speaking about the Fokker conjecture and not about the Fokker theorem. Once I wrote a paper, and the referee was very angry, and he wrote that today you cannot say Fokker conjecture, you should say Fokker theorem. That if you say Fokker conjecture, you will suspect that the proof is not correct, and so on. And I had to answer that, being a logician, I distinguish Fokker theorem as a statement with a proof, and Fokker conjecture by itself as a statement. So I will be speaking about Fokker conjecture without any doubts in the validity of the proof given by Appel and Hacker. And their proof was published 40 years ago in Illinois Journal of Mathematics. And people from Illinois decided to publish this year a special issue of the same Illinois Journal of Mathematics devoted to Hacker. Appel unfortunately passed away. And they invited me to contribute to this special issue and asked to write something about the Fokker conjecture. And I found that it is a good opportunity to present such an equation in details. And of course we could do it quite easily using the powerful technique of the Deep-Aryan theorem, but then it would give no hope to use it for something reasonable like analyzing the proof of Appel and Hacker in terms of this equation. So it would be interesting to construct such an equation using as much as possible the peculiarity of this problem and to use as simple arithmetic as possible. At the time I was writing the paper, I did not expect that I will be speaking about it here, but I tried to use very, very weak arithmetic techniques. So there will be three steps. It is more convenient to think in a dual form instead of saying that Fokker is statement that solution has no, the equation has no solutions. We will speak about saying that the Fokker conjecture is not true if and only if this equation has a solution. And clearly, every solution of this equation should encode a map contradicting the Fokker conjecture. And the three steps will be standard. First, we will obtain what is known as Davis number form, a restatement of this negation in the form there exists something, then one bounded universal quantifier, then the existence quantifiers, and then polynomial equation. And you will see later why I used here such indexing D6 and D4, for example. The next step will be transformation to pure existential formula at the expense of using exponentiation here. And the last is just elimination of the exponentiation. I will be speaking mainly about this part because it is the original part. If I have time, I will say a few words about the second part and I will say nothing about the elimination of exponentiation because after so many years, we essentially have no other techniques than the one originally invented in 1970. So at first we need somehow to express the Fokker conjecture in terms of numbers. So let us consider such a spiral graph, just we have a path and we number the vertices 1, 2, 3 and so on. m is the just, this is just an example with m the number of vertices. And I wish to introduce another parameter, n, and to add more edges. We have such spiral edges that connect two vertices with numbers y, I and j, even only if the distance is 1. And now we will add radial edges corresponding to this difference being equal to this particular number n. Here is another example with larger values of m and n. And I can do the following. I can remove some edges, and my connected graph will split into a number of connected components. And I will call these components countries, and consider two countries as neighbors if there was an edge with n's in both countries and this edge was removed. And my claim is that every geographical map is isomorphic to such a discrete map. In fact, we can take sufficiently dense spiral graph and represent each country by vertices inside corresponding country. Do you agree with me?
So the borders, are the all borders obvious to reconstruct from the...
Sorry?
Are the borders obvious to reconstruct from this graph? The borders from the initial... I mean, is it easy to define the what are the borders?
Borders of the...
Borders of the countries.
From here?
Yeah.
It is a discrete map, it's not have a border
in that sense. You need to define the borders. I mean, you need to, when you model the problem, you need to define which...
Yes. If there was an edge here removed, then I need two countries, these two countries to have different colors. I remember what edges were removed.
A single node is a country?
Sorry?
A single node is a country, no?
It doesn't happen to be a country, why not?
I don't. Small country.
Sorry?
A small country.
And once I wrote a paper with such definition of discrete maps, and one of the referees wrote, no, that's not evident, it should be proved. And I had to add several pages explaining how we can construct this discrete representation of a random geographical map. I submitted revisited version, and then another referee wrote, this is evident, and this should be crossed out. How can we define which edges to be removed? We can do the following. We can just color each country in a particular case, color vertices in some way, and then say that we remove all edges having different colors at its ends. And then there will be a splitting of the original spiral graph into countries, and they will be connected components. So I will use colors as definition of countries. And clearly, if I use as many colors as number of countries, I would be able to define the map in this way. But actually, I can be much more economical. There is a five-color theorem, rather simple, and even more simply, six-color theorem saying that six colors are always enough. This trivially follows from Euler's theorem, because in every map there should be a country with just five neighbors. We can remove this country, color the rest of the map, and then add the removed country. So six colors are enough to produce any discrete map. And I will say that two colorings are equivalent if they produce the same discrete map. So we color vertices, remove edges with different colors, and in both cases we obtain the same map. And then, therefore, color conjecture in version 1 states just that for every six coloring, there is an equivalent for coloring. Now we can use numbers, we can just assign numbers to colors, and we can code a color in the vertices of our spiral graph just by forming such a sum. We take the number of color, multiply by some number, and make this summation. The question is what to select for the role of these numbers alphas. And you can guess that I would select the well-known sequences of solution of Pell's equations defined by initial conditions in this recurrent equation. I repeat, this is again the statement of the four-color conjecture, but we have to work in the dual form. So in dual form we have that negation of four-color conjecture states that there is a six-coloring that has no equivalent four-coloring. And we need to explain two properties. When two colorings are equivalent and when a coloring uses only four colors. Yet another formulation of negation of the four-color conjecture. There are numbers m and n, the parameters of the spiral graph, and number d6, which determines the sixth coloring of this spiral graph, such that whatever is a number before, it is not a coloring, for coloring. That is, either the two maps are not equivalent, or the coloring uses some color larger than 3. If we have a number written in this form, this representation is not unique, unfortunately. I will write the such representation in this form, meaning that this is not product, but just digits in this positional system of notation. Unfortunately, we have this relation, and so this representation is not unique. And we need to select a particular representation. Yes, this is an example of not uniqueness. We have, this is the same number, but it is two different representations of such form. And we will use greedy notation, which can be defined by such an algorithm. If d is 0, then we just take m equal to 0, we have no digits at all. If it is small enough, we just take m equal to 1, and d1 equal to this d. Otherwise, we select the largest possible m, which larger alpha m is still less than b. Select the first digit as this ratio, and then define the rest from the greedy notation of this difference. So each time we try to select m as large as possible and each d as large as possible. This was a definition of a greedy notation by an algorithm, but we can give you a syntactical definition. Namely, we should impose two conditions. The whole digit should be less than 7, because we have such an identity. And also, this representation cannot contain the pattern 6, 5, 5, 5, 6, because we have another identity. Such a sum is equal to such sum is here n plus 1, which is greater than alpha n here. So this is the syntactical definition of the greedy notation. And the j's digits in the grid notation of d will be denoted in this way. Now we can reformulate the negation of the four-color conjecture using our new notation. There are numbers m, n determining the size of the spiral graph, number d6 determining a particular map. Now we can impose the bound on this d6 by this alpha with n plus 1, such that for every d4 we can also bound it by the same number. There is a number k such that either the digits, the k's digits of d4 is at least 4. So this is not a 4 color. Or this d4 defines a map different from d6. And for this there are possibilities. Either the colors in d6 are the same, but the colors in d4 are different. Or the colors in d4 in d6 are different, but they are the same in d4. This is for the case of the spiral edge. And the same for the case of the radial edge, when I have here, instead of k plus 1, k plus n. And here is the main technical idea. It is difficult to work with these sequences, to express the nth terms of the alpha sequences. And the idea was to avoid passing from index of a member of the sequence and to work only with the members of the sequences. So, capital number m will be represented by this pair of numbers m1 and m2, which should be equal to consecutive members of our sequence. And similar, n will be represented by two numbers, n1 and 0, and they should be consecutive numbers in our sequence. And similar for k. There are very nice relations between elements of the sequences. In particular, we can express k plus l's element in such a by such a polynomial of k's and l's elements of the sequence. In particular, we have such nice condition, and this condition characterizes the sequences. We have the following lemma with this counterpart of Hertz Gödel lemma for Bell equation. If some number satisfy this equation and x0 is less than x1, then for sure they are consecutive numbers of our sequence. That was the reason to select alphas as a base in our notational system. Because we can easily express the fact that these pairs are consecutive elements of our sequence. And instead of using this delta telling us the nth element of number d, I want to use this capital delta relation given to numbers L0 and L1. They should be consecutive elements of our sequence. And E should be the nth element of this number d. If we are able to express this relation in a definite way, we will be able to reformulate the negation of the four-color conjecture via a definite equation. Here is the most difficult reformulation of the four-color conjecture. The negations can be stated as follows. There are numbers m1 and 0, as I said, encoding the size of the spiral graph. M1 and 0 encoding the latent subradial edges. D6 encoding the map, satisfying the natural conditions here we can state this in the form of different equations, such that for every number default, there are numbers k0 and k1 indicating the place where something wrong happens, namely either the digit in number default is greater or equal to 4, or at some places the maps generated by d6 and d4 are different. So either L1 is the next, which corresponds the next number in our sequence, which corresponds to radial edge, or it is a distance n which corresponds to the radial edge, and there are numbers which are just digits of d6 and these positions, and now these numbers are on the same positions, but in d4. And either these numbers are equal, but these numbers are not equal, or these numbers are non-equal, and these numbers are equal. Which means that these numbers define different maps. We can define numbers alpha n in an algebraic way, which is well known. These alphas are given by such an expression where omega is this number, or vice versa, we can express the say, negative power powers on these numbers via our alphas. And what is important in the signal is that the fractional part of this number is just this value, this value. Now we can start construct definite definition of this delta. This is its original definition. We need somehow extract a digits of d via definite equations. We could try to split our number d into two parts. Just cut it in the proper place. And from this part, we can easily extract its leading digit. Namely, the leading digit will be just the integer part of this ratio. We need just to divide to L0, so it's like because we need just our alpha is not element of our sequence. The problem is only to cut number d into two parts, left hand side and right hand side, in such a way that here we have lower digits, and here we have higher digits. And for this we can impose several conditions on these numbers dA and dR. First condition is rather simple. This number should contain at most n digits. And this is easy to express. We just say that it should be less than alpha with index L plus 1 minus 1, because L plus 1 is exactly this number, which would be the next digit position here. It is less evident how we can express the fact that the L ends with at least L zeros, but luckily it can be expressed. Namely, it turns out that the fractional part of this number should be very small. The larger our numbers, they are better. Then omega multiplied by this number is smaller and smaller, and after summation we should obtain something very small. And the most tricky thing is to express another important property, that this number cannot end by 6555, and this number cannot begin with 5, 5 and 6 at the same time. Because in such a case, we would have to hear a forbidden pattern 6555556. And likely this also can be expressed. In fact, we need just to strengthen these two conditions, one of them. Either we need to subtract here another small quantity, or we need to subtract alpha L here. And so we obtain the necessary things for definite definition of capital delta. This relation holds if and only if there are numbers d, l, d, sorry, dr, of course, and number f, such that the following condition holds. This is almost what we needed. These are not quite definite equations, but you can easily bring all conditions to the required form. First of all, we need to get rid of this square root of 45, which comes in our number omega. But actually, omega, this square root comes only in the form of linear inequalities. And then we can easily replace every linear inequality with square root of 25 into a system of other inequalities connected by conjunction and disjunctions. In a standard way, you can eliminate inequalities, strict and non-strict inequalities, and can combine either conjunction or disjunction of two equations into a single equation. And finally, in this way, you would obtain the desired definite expressions for capital delta, and then we can combine all these conditions into a single definite equation. And in this way, we would obtain what we are looking for. We would obtain such a representation for the negation of the four-color conjecture expressed in Davis form. First, a number of existential quantifiers, single bounded universal quantifier, existential quantifiers, and then a definite equation. So we need to eliminate this bounded universal quantifier. And this can be done in many ways. The original technique was developed by Martin Davis and Hilary Putnam in 1959. But unfortunately, they were forced to use a conjecture that for every case there exists an arithmetical progression of length k consisting entirely of prime numbers. At the time it was considered to be a very positive conjecture, but it was proved only almost half a century later by Green and Town. And so now we can use the original technique of Davis and Putnam. But luckily they did not wait for so long, because here Julia Riverson came to help, and she was able to modify the construction of Davis and Putnam and eliminate progression of prime numbers by progression of pairwise relative prime numbers having large prime factors. But in my paper I used yet another technique which I found much later. Namely, I used what I call multiplicative version of the principle, which allowed us to forget about prime numbers and deal just with the arithmetical progression of arbitrarily big relative prime numbers. No longer we need to have the prime numbers themselves. And I just want to finish by presenting what is multiplicative version of the Dirichlet principle, because it is not widely known. There are two forms. A simple form states that if you have number r divided the product of some numbers, then there are numbers q and index j such that q divides r, q divides one of these factors, and q is large enough. And this inequality corresponds to two pigeons in one box in a classical Dirichlet principle. But here we need to deal with many existential quantifiers after the universal quantifier. So we need a multidimensional multiplicative version of the Dirichlet principle, stating that we have number r divided several products, then we can find the number q and corresponding indices, such that q divides r, in each product q divides at least one factor, and Q is still large enough. And this mathematical form of Dirichlet principles can be used for elimination of power difference quantifier. Thank you for attention.
Have you any questions or comments?
At the beginning, you mentioned four problems, each of which can be reformulated as a statement about solutions of some particular level. Okay. It seems there is a similarity between all of the four problems, Fermat, Ulbach, Riemann, and Foucault. If I am correct, each of which is pi 1 statement. So maybe there is a more or less general method to construct from any particular pi 1 statement some Diophantine equation.
Yes, of course, but we cannot do anything but pi 1 because we need to obtain finally irrational formula.
Yeah.
Yes, and the problem only is how to reduce pi 1 formula. It's not trivial for the Riemann hypothesis, for example. Mm-hmm. It's trivial for Fermat's theorem and for Gödel's conjecture. Yes, we can do it for every pi 1 formula.
How many variables will be in the final equation C?
It's an exercise.
So basically, what's the gain of this particular construction of this equation compared to applying this general MDRP theorem? So will there be some numerical bounds improved or something? Number of variables, number of quantifiers?
I don't think that the number of variables is so important. But okay, I can write a program for Turing machine which would try all maps and verify that each map is coverable. Mm-hmm. But I guess you won't be able to understand anything about the proof of Abel and Hacken in terms of the work of this Turing machine. So understanding the proof in these terms might be easier than in terms of the complicated machine which works back and forth along the... The idea is to have a straightforward reduction so we can reproduce the original proof in terms of equations.
Which is supposed to help you to solve the equation that you produced from the formulation of the problem, or which is... So, which way do you think that interesting results will come?
The very hypothetical way is to understand technique of Abel and Hacken in terms of equations. What it means for analyzing this particular class of equations.
This might be an extremely naive question. So do you know an example? First, your theorem shows that neophonetics are terribly difficult to structure. But do you know any example where actually some progress has been obtained in combinatorial questions, like say for all of your examples you gave, exactly by reducing the equation? I think that for usual mathematicians, the idea that basically any that kind of problem can be reduced to some system of polynomial equations is something not quite probably understood. So do you know any example that this logical insight that you can reduce this to polynomials has helped someone actually solve the problem?
No, I don't know. Sorry.
Okay, that's what I suspected, but...
Yeah.
but based on your introduction, I think it's...
Who formulated this principle, integrative version?
I don't know. I found it myself, maybe it was before, but... I don't know whom to attribute. But it's as trivial as original.
It's your principle.
I don't refer to any I don't know.
I suggest first to thank Yuri for this talk. Secondly, for all his scientific production. And there is a lot of reason, but finally for his 70th birthday, 2 months and 4 days later.